Okay, let's get started. So today we will be discussing about symmetric multiprocessors, popularly called as SMPs. So as we were discussing in the last class, this is possibly the most popular shared memory architecture that we come across in the commercial processors. The SMPs are very popular. So here, as we were discussing the architecture, each processor has its own cache, and the interconnection among processors is a bus. And we were discussing why bus is a possible interconnection between the processors, why not a network and things like that we were discussing last time. So here the access time for all memory locations is equal. Any processor can, the average access time for the memory is the same because all basically interact through the bus, right? All processors get the data on the bus, so the access time is the same, or in other words, the access time is symmetric with respect to all the processors. So we'll keep this architecture in mind as we proceed with today's discussions. Is this all right? So far in our discussions, we have been saying that the processors are becoming very fast. The cycle time is gigahertz and so on, whereas the memory access is the bottleneck. And we had discussed about various techniques to speed up cache, main memory, and so on. But even then, the main memory is still the bottleneck in modern computers. In a single processor, the situation was bad enough. But what about multiprocessors? When multiple processors contend for the same memory, the situation can become still worse. Of course, we were discussing about solutions like multi-level caches to reduce the memory demand on the memory system by the processor. So the multi-level caches reduce the memory demand on the memory by a processor. And possibly by using multi-level caches, it would be possible for more than one processor to meaningfully share a memory bus. So we should be able to reduce the number of transactions to the memory to the minimum. And as we will see, that higher and higher levels of caches become important as we go for larger and larger number of symmetric multiprocessors. L3, etc., would become more common. We have been discussing about L2. So definitely L2 would be there in any SMPs that you talk of for it to function meaningfully, and even there might be L3 cache. So a multi-level cache is a must in any SMP. Now let's look at how SMPs have evolved, the SMP organizations have evolved over the years. The earliest SMPs appeared in 1980s, and here they were, each processor and its cache were on separate extension boards. Appeared in 1980s, and here the processor boards were plugged on to the backplane. Of course, the time for communication between the processors would be large because they are communicating on a backplane bus, right? What is a backplane bus? Anybody knows about a backplane bus? Heard about the term? Yes, anybody like to comment anything at all? What is a back? Have you heard about this term like backplane, etc.? In old computers, these were there. A backplane bus is a single bus. Unlike the architecture that we have discussed few, I think last class or so, that there are separate buses, the processor memory bus because that needs to be very fast, whereas the I/O bus is asynchronous bus. A backplane bus is a single bus on which memory, I/O devices, everything is interconnected. It used to be a popular architecture, 1980s and 70s. So the different processor boards were plugged onto the backplane. And in 1990s, you can buy a board with multiple processors on the same processor, sorry, on the same board, several processor chips will be mounted, and the servers that were available in 1990s, you can get 4 to 6 processors per board. And since 2000, we are getting the processors that are integrated in the same packaging called as a multi-core processor, right? Like dual core, quad core, and things like that, which we'll later discuss a little bit. Now, what about the SMPs? Why are they so popular? They are so popular because programming is very easy. Here, any program, a C program or any program you write, can run on SMPs. And especially when the communication pattern is very complex and very dynamically during execution, this would definitely be very easy to write the program compared to a message passing architecture. But what about the disadvantage of SMPs? We talked about advantages and said it's very popular. What about disadvantages? Yes, there are many disadvantages. One is about scalability. The problem is that the processors are connected on a bus. And we know that as the number of processors increase, the traffic on the bus increases, and the contention among the processors for the bus increases, and as a result, the performance degrades very rapidly after certain time, certain number of processors. So, looks like using a single processor, using a single bus called as a backside bus, in contrast to, we'll discuss about the backside and the frontside bus later on. So, the bus connecting the processors, if there is a single bus, then more than 16 processors would make it almost unusable. So, how do you overcome that? People have thought various ways, and one possible way is to use switches. You know that switches set up point-to-point connections rather than having a single connection used in a contention basis. The switches can set up point-to-point connections between different processors. And if we had more classes devoted to this, we might have spent little bit time later about different switches like crossbar, multistage, etc. And because specially these are not used in the commercial computers, we'll not discuss. Maybe in futuristic computers, when we have large number of SMPs, very large number of processors, might be they will be used, the switches. But the problem with switches is that it makes it very difficult to implement the cache coherence protocol. We'll see that for every SMP, one of the important things that need to be tackled is the cache coherence problem. And we will have a cache coherence protocol running on a chip or controllers, which can ensure that the caches on different processors are coherent. And for that, we need a broadcast medium. If we have a point-to-point connection, then implementing cache coherence will become very difficult. So, till now, we don't know how to overcome this problem about switches. So, the other thing that the vendors are thinking of is to have multiple buses. So, as the number of processors and SMPs increase, we might have to use more than one buses. But for our discussions here, we will consider only a single bus connecting the processors. So, what about running conventional programs like a C program on a SMP machine, because you know SMP machines have become common everywhere. Now you don't even find a uniprocessor machine in the entire lab, and even Intel has stopped manufacturing single processor machines. All are SMPs now, right? Even on the desktop. So if you run a C program which was running on a uniprocessor, would it run faster on a SMP? The answer is yes, it will experience a performance increase. That's because even though there is a single thread of execution, still the kernel routines, etc., they can run on separate processor. As a result, a single thread program can also run faster. So as we are saying that almost every processor you find in the market is multi-core, Pentium 4, Xeon, Athlon, Decalpha, UltraSpark, etc. Earlier, only the servers like the Xeon, Opteron, and such servers were multiprocessors. Now even on desktop you have multiprocessors. So we'll discuss about that. But what about multi-cores? What was wrong with making a single processor fast? Why have multiple cores or multiple processors rather than making a single processor fast? So that's the question we're trying to address here. Why not the vendors try for a faster single processor? Why not make the single processor faster? Why go for multi-core processors, basically SMPs? Because SMPs, we'll see that there are big problems there. To implement SMP, cache coherence, we'll see that it will become a headache. We'll discuss about that today. And synchronization, these are two very vexing problems in any multiprocessor. So why not have a single processor where such problems don't exist? So this is because further increasing circuit complexity would be unsustainable. We're saying that the temperature, the power dissipation is 100 watts, and if the same rate of increase in circuit complexity continues for another 3 or 4 years, we'll have 1000 watts processors. Processor dissipating 1000 watts. Just imagine, 1000 watt can cook tea, right, in 5 minutes. So just imagine the kind of temperature it will generate. And also the clock skew. So these are two big headaches that the vendors finding it very difficult to overcome. And they are rather trying to reduce the clock rate, as you will see that the multi-cores have smaller clock rate, smaller temperature dissipation. And we have separate processors, processor chips in the same semiconductor packaging. So the other problem is use of more complex techniques to improve single thread performance is limited. We had seen about the bottlenecks or how difficult it would be to carry on the ILP any further, instruction level parallelism. Lot of advancements have been made, but making further advancements doesn't look very feasible. So the transistors now are put in separate cores rather than trying to increase transistors on a single core. So these are the multiple cores are in the same physical packaging. Each core executes different threads. And the advantage is that a core would be automatically switched off if no thread is there to execute, right? Because power dissipation is a major problem. It can reduce power dissipation. So later on, we'll look at the multi-core processors. But what about the cache organization? Of course, the L1 cache would have to be a private to a processor. L1 caches are always private to a core. Why is that? Anybody like to say, why are L1 caches always private to a core? Because the L1 cache access time determines the processor cycle time, isn't it? We had seen that. So we can't have L1 cache shared. We have to have fast L1 cache access time. But what about L2 cache? Would it be shared or would it be private? So both these configurations have their advantages. Now let's compare them and see which may be a feasible way. The advantage of a shared L2 cache is that the size of the cache or the space of the cache would be very efficiently used, right? Because data shared among multiple cores is not replicated. So the data, the cache size can be whatever be the size, it will be very efficiently used, or the dynamic use of space by each core would be efficient, right? So whatever be the requirement for each processor, the data requirement can be accommodated more easily if they are combined rather than they are separate. And also we will see that the various protocol implementations we will see later, like coherency protocol, etc., they would become very easy because every block would be very easy to identify. They would have a fixed home on the cache. They would be easier to identify. But in spite of all these advantages, we will see that a private L2 cache is something that most of the commercial processors use. The main reason is that there is a private bus to the private cache, and therefore the access time would be fast, right? But maybe when we have L3 cache, etc., we'll have to again see whether that would be shared or private, similar considerations. Now, as we are saying that, just connecting the processors together with their caches is not enough. We'll have to find out what problems they create. Possibly the biggest problem is the coherence problem. But what is the coherence problem? Actually, if you tell anybody that you have done a course and have done SMPs and so on, the first question they will ask, even in our Bibles, the first question they will ask, what is a cache coherence problem and how is it overcome in the modern processors? So please look at it carefully, and then they will say that give us some examples about how problems can arise in a coherent cache. What is a coherent cache? Give examples of how problems can arise if the caches are not coherent and so on, right? So let's look at those things. So here, because the different processors have their own private cache, L1 and L2 caches, the same data might be replicated in multiple caches if they are used in different processors. And the processors might update this data, and as a result, the data in the different caches might become inconsistent. So you will get a wrong result if the data become inconsistent in the different caches. So what would be an efficient way to enforce cache coherency? See, an inefficient solution might be, you will say that, see, the processor should not share data, they should work on separate data and so on, but those solutions are not acceptable. The processors will share data. So let's see that we have to find some way for a processor to find out if anyone has changed data in its private cache and be able to get the latest value of the data. So this is an example problem that might arise if we don't have a coherent cache. Just see here. This is the memory, okay? This is the memory, and we had a variable called as u having value 5, right? U has value 5. And then in the first cycle or first step, let's say processor 1 requested u and got the value u equal to 5, right? In its own private cache. And in the second step, The third processor, P3, it requested the same data for doing some other operation, and it got U equal to 5. In the third operation, P3 incremented U by 2 and wrote U is 7 here in its own private cache, right? In the fourth step, P1 is trying to find out what's the value of U, and it already has U in its private cache. So here it has updated the value in the P3's private cache, U is 7. So if it reads 5, then it will be reading an old value of U. And similarly, if P2 requests the value of U, will it get 5 from here on the bus, or will it get 7, and things like that. So here the different processors might work with different values for the same variables. So that's the cache coherency problem, very severe problem. Unless we overcome this, SMP cannot be used. Now let's look at the solutions. The main idea here to maintain a cache coherence is to track the state of sharing of every data block. So what this means is that every data block, we have to somehow keep track who is having a copy of that and what is he doing with that. Is he just reading that? Is he writing onto that, and so on. So the state of sharing, that is who are sharing and what are they doing with that. For every data block, we'll have to do that. So all coherence protocols are essentially based on this idea, that every block has to be tracked. Somehow we have to keep track of the information about every data block. Either at one place or at several places, we'll have to keep track of this information. Who are the processors that are using this? What are they doing with that? So based on this idea, we can have the following solution. Recognize any potential inconsistency at runtime and carry out preventive action. So if we are able to track the states and we find that two are writing or two or more, then we know that problem is bound to arrive. And as long as one is writing, as long as all are reading, then there is no problem. If one is writing, then those who are reading, they should read from this processor only, right? They should not read their private data. Then also problem will arise, right? So we should be able to find out who is doing what, or especially if someone is writing, and then carry out preventive action, like allowing only one to write, and if others have private copies for reading, just invalidate that, right, or update that with this new data. So this is the main idea here, that for every block shared data, somewhere we have to keep track. Maybe here, what are the data that are being used here, and who else are using this, and so on. Or maybe at some other place, like near the main memory, somewhere we'll have to keep track of that. And then as the actions occur on the bus, we'll have to monitor that and take preventive actions. So the advantage of this solution is that the coherent cache maintenance would not be a headache for programmers. The programmers will execute their program as if there is no coherency problem. They are using a single processor. And for the compilers, operating system, etc., the problem will be transparent. They won't be able to find out that such a problem could arise, right? But the penalty is that we'll have to have some hardware, somewhere to keep track of the information, a controller to monitor the activities on the bus, and then take preventive actions. So two protocols. summarize the solutions that are available. Only two protocols. One is called as the Snoopy protocol or the snooping protocol. The main idea here is that some controller at the cache snoops or tries to find out what is going on the bus, what data is being transmitted, by whom, etc. Right? So each cache would have a controller which will monitor the bus for all the traffic that pass on the bus and find out who is transmitting or receiving data and what type of data, right? The other protocol is called as a directory protocol. Here processors don't have to snoop, but here in a directory which may be implemented in the main memory, the memory controller. The memory controller would keep track of the sharing state of each data block. Here the processors don't snoop, but the sharing status is maintained by the memory controller, and the directory is decentralized for the directory may be a decentralized one for large multiprocessors. And here it is has advantages because it prevents broadcasts, right? We'll see, we'll compare these further about these two solutions. One based on snooping the bus and the other is maintaining information in the memory controller. Not really. See, we will see the solution. See, he says that whether every access would require an access to the memory. No, not really. Then it would be unusable. We will see that the directory would be at the memory controller, and the memory controller will somehow prevent more than one processor having the same block in a read state. And also, if one is writing, the other should not have the same block in read state, and so on. We'll see that, the solution. But for every transaction, it doesn't have to be reported yet. Right? We'll see that solution. So, the two solutions, if you will look at, in one solution, we have a controller associated with a cache, which will somehow monitor the bus, trying to find out what is going on and update its information. If more processors request reading the same block, it will update. And if this processor tries to write, then somehow those processors which have that same block in read, it has to ask them to invalidate the block. Right? That's the Snoopy protocol. Is that all right? See, we are saying that as long as this processor is reading, it will also keep track of who else are reading the same block. And any number of processors reading one block is not a problem. But if one processor starts to write, then the other will have old copies. And therefore, it has to ask those processors which are having the reading the same data to invalidate. Right? We'll see the solution. On the other one, we will maintain the sharing state of all blocks being used by all the processors somewhere with a memory controller near the main memory. And then, of course, they can be distributed among different memory modules. And then it will monitor who is doing what. And then if two processors request for writing, right, then it will invalidate one of them, allow one to only write. We'll see how it will do that.
Sir,
yeah.
Since it is multiprocessing, two processors can work at the same clock.
Right,
clock.
Right.
So if they both want to write at the same
yes,
time,
yes.
Is it
yeah.
addressed in the Snoopy protocol? Is the problem?
Yeah, let's find out about how that can be handled. Can anybody answer the solution? See, the question that he is asking is that two processors generate write signal at the same time, precisely same clock, they start writing to the same data, precisely, right? So what would happen? Can anybody?
Some prioritization thing.
Anybody answer this question?
Whoever writes later.
No, not later. On the same cycle, we are saying.
No, but writing finish, whoever finish writing.
No, no. Please understand. The writing don't occur asynchronously. They occur synchronously, on the same cycle. Right,
so
on same clock cycle.
Write occurs and it occurs on the L2 cache. L2 cache can be the coherence can be maintained at the L2 level, not at the L1 level. So we can
actually. No, no. See, please answer the question that he is asking. That two processors are generating write signal onto the bus. At the same time, they can generate, because this is a synchronous bus. Precisely at the same instant, they can generate write signals. How will that be handled? No, it's not. See, this is a bus like you might have read in a first level course, a bus in a processor or in a memory and processor interconnection bus and things like that. So what will that do if two processors write? Anybody remembers first level course? Okay. Sorry? No. Please answer something sensible, not like mutex, etc. You are going too far-fetched and too, what I can say, like a person who has never read the course. The first level course, anybody remembers, about concurrent access to a bus. Okay, see, since you have all forgotten about the first level course, let me just tell that the bus serializes access, because if you can just think of the first course, you will see that there is a bus master and slave. A master can initiate requests, and when there are multiple masters, there is a bus request and bus grant lines. Please look up a first level book, bus request and bus grant lines. And if bus requests come at the same time, then there is a arbitration, right? And there are several types of arbitration, including daisy chaining, right? Some processor or the main processor always has first priority, or it can be more complex where it will be decided depending on what they are doing and so on, right? So see the various types of arbitration protocols that normal bus implements, right? So the one that would use would depend on who is granted the bus for his bus request, who gets the bus grant, and then only he can use. So every bus serializes requests. It is not possible that two will write at the same time. Okay, so let's compare the Snoopy and the directory protocol. To think of it, a Snoopy protocol reduces the traffic to the memory. We'll see how. A Snoopy protocol reduces the traffic to the memory. Can anybody answer this? I mean, can anybody think of how a Snoopy protocol can reduce traffic to the memory? Okay, see here, in a Snoopy protocol, if one processor has the latest value, it will just forward it to the other processors without writing it to the memory, right? Or one processor can read it from there. And here, every write has to be, I mean, not every write, whenever another processor reads, it has to be updated here and then forwarded and so on, right? And also, the memory controller has to keep track of these activities. So the memory traffic would increase if we use a directory protocol. Snoopy protocol would reduce traffic, would become clear when we discuss with examples later. So, on the other hand, a Snoopy protocol will require broadcast, and all other processors would be able to monitor the bus. And inherently, a Snoopy protocol is associated with a shared bus. So, this is the problem we are discussing, that why increasing the number of processors in SMP would be difficult. Because see, the cache coherence protocol would require a shared bus. Switch would be very difficult to use. How do you broadcast using a switch? Right? It would be very inefficient to broadcast using a switch. Whereas here, in a bus, it can be, the protocol can be very simply implemented, and the essence of a Snoopy protocol is broadcasts. So, for shared bus, if we are bound to a shared bus, scalability is a problem. And as we are saying that some workarounds have been tried, the enterprise server has up to 4 buses and so on. We'll look at that later. Now, let's discuss about the Snoopy protocol. So, here, as soon as one processor requests a data block, the request is put on the bus, and the request is monitored by the other processors. They are snooped, and they check if they have a copy. If they have a copy, they just send it across, right? So, works well with bus interconnection, because all transmissions on a bus are essentially broadcast, and implementing a Snoopy protocol is effortless. And almost every machine, every commercial processor, SMPs, etc., we discuss multicore, all those use a Snoopy protocol. So, let's look at the different categories of Snoopy protocol. There are essentially 2 categories, invalidate and broadcast. So, please, as a homework, please try out what are the disadvantages of a directory protocol if it is implemented in a SMP. What disadvantages might occur if a directory protocol for cache coherence is implemented for SMP? Don't have to submit, just think about it, right? We had given the hints what problems might occur, but please think about it. Okay, so the different categories of Snoopy protocol, let's look at the different solutions within the Snoopy protocol that may be possible. One is called as the write invalidate, the other is called as a write broadcast protocol. First, let's understand what is this protocol, these 2 categories of protocols, and then let's see which is more advantageous and so on. So, the write invalidate protocol, as the name says, when a processor writes to its own cache, then all other processors having a copy of that data block are asked to invalidate that block. Because if they continue reading their own block, then there will be inconsistency. So, if one starts to write, it has to first ask the other processors which have a copy of that same block to invalidate their blocks, and then only it can start writing, right? So, what about the write broadcast? The write broadcast protocol, here whatever value it writes to its own cache, it broadcasts it to all processors, and the controller associated with their cache will update the new value onto the value that they have, onto the value that are available in other processors will be updated as soon as a processor tries to write. So, one is the write invalidate. One processor, before it could start writing, it asks all other processors to first invalidate if they have the same block in a read mode. So, as long as one is having a write, he will have it exclusively, no one else will have that block. He will have an exclusive copy of that block, and then only he can write. Whereas, when all are reading, they can have a same copy replicated. But in a write broadcast, several processors can have the same block even when write is occurring, right? So basically, as soon as it writes, that is also updated in all other caches, right? So that way, a consistent data in all caches is ensured. So these are the two broad categories of Snoopy protocol, the invalidate and update protocols or broadcast protocol. So the update is also called as broadcast. Write invalidate and write update or write invalidate and write broadcast protocols. I'm sorry, can you please elaborate your question? No, we didn't talk of priority of read or write. See, we are saying that when you update a value, when a processor is writing a value, a new value is being assigned to the data. And as a result, those who are having the same value in the read mode will have old value, and somehow we will have to invalidate that, right? Okay, don't get so confused. Okay, please read through again what we're discussing. We're discussing about memory optimizations on write back cache and so on. So that's an entirely different thing, right? Please read back. So I think he's write priority over read and things like that, right? That's what you're saying. On their own cache, they have same copies in the read mode, right? Yes. Right. So another processor, any processor which wants to write, will have to somehow invalidate all others. As soon as it places a write request for the same block, it has to be invalidated. At any time in the write invalidate, any time only one block can have exclusive access for write. If it has exclusive access, the same block cannot be present in other blocks, in other caches.
So write won't have to wait until read occurs.
No. See, a write, as soon as it occurs, before a write can occur, it has to invalidate. Unless the invalidate is complete, it can't write. Simple.
Write invalidate is essentially invalidate and then write.
Exactly.
Write update is before
At the same time. At the same time, the value has to be updated. A broadcast is all the caches are updated at the same time. Okay. Now let's see how an invalidate protocol will work. So there are two cases. One is about writing to a data that is saved. The other is about handling a read miss. One processor doesn't have a data, right, because it has been invalidated or whatever, or maybe it is requesting that new, it didn't have that data, it is just requesting to read that data. So let's see how that will happen. These are the two important cases here in the invalidate protocol. One is about writing to saved data. So here, before it can write, an invalidate command is sent on the bus, and all caches other than the one that is writing would snoop and invalidate their copies that they have. So just a clarification here, that even though for simplicity we said that the essential idea is that keep track of which processor is having which data block and so on, so that would not be the case for a Snoopy protocol. We don't really keep track. We don't add on information, say P3 is sharing, P4 is sharing, etc. We don't. Whereas in a directory protocol, we'll have to keep track which processor is sharing. Here, because of the Snoopy nature, we are able to overcome exactly storing who all is using that data. Right? Is that all right? So it just broadcasts, and all processors which are having copies for the same block, they invalidate the block. Is that okay? So that is about handling write to a saved data. But what about a read miss? So read miss would be different for a right throw and a right back catch. In a right throw, it is very simple because memory is always up to date, right? So it just reads it. Whereas in a right back, somehow the one that is having the latest copy would have to snoop and find out and then send that copy, right? A read request by another processor should be known to the processor that is currently holding the copy, right? It should find out by snooping and then send the copy. Is that okay? So one, it gets from the memory, the other, it would be sent by the processor.
So in the right back case,
yes.
Two, if a readme suffers, there is two L1 cache access for the miss.
In a right throw, is it? Which one you are saying?
In a
right back. Sorry, can you elaborate
in
your question?
Back,
yes.
If a readme occurs.
Readme occurs, yes.
So processor which is doing the read.
A read, yes.
First accesses his own cache and sees that it is a miss. And after that, it snoops for the.
No, no. See, the one that is reading doesn't have to snoop. It just puts a read request on the bus. The one that is having the latest data snoops and finds out that somebody is requesting the same block. And it has to send it, right?
So who does the processor know that I have the latest protocol?
We'll see that. The exact way it is implemented. See, he's asking about how such a protocol can be implemented. Right? How can a processor know that it has its own copy? That's implementation. We'll discuss about the implementation.
Sir.
Yes, please.
And the main memory data will be updated.
We'll also look at that. See, his question is that would the main memory data be updated at what time? We will also look at that. We will take up a efficient representation for a block and find out what happens when various requests come in. So about the write invalidate protocol in a write throw cache, as we are saying, it is a simple implementation. When there is a write to shared data broadcast on the bus, the processor snoop and update any copies. And a read miss, of course, the memory is always up to date, it can be read. But about concurrent writes, we had also discussed about the serialization, right? So that will take care of it. The bus provides basic arbitration support. You can find out in a first level book how is arbitration support provided by a bus. And that will ensure that two writes don't occur at the same time, right? Now, the invalidate, it exploits special locality in the sense that even if multiple writes to different words of the same block occur, only one request is sent out to invalidate. Just try to understand that one bus transaction for any number of writes to the same block. So if a processor first time it tries to write, it invalidates the copies that are there in other blocks, then it can write any number of times to the same block, it can write to the same word or to the other words in the same block. So that's the special locality. So once it has exclusive access, it can write to any number of times. And as a result, it is efficient. On the other hand, a broadcast, this is also a Snoopy solution we had seen, isn't it, updating. So here, for every write, it has to be broadcast on the bus. And as a result, the bus traffic will be too much. And we have already seen that bus is a bottleneck because several processors are trying to share it, right? So an invalidate protocol has a very important advantage. It reduces traffic on the bus, efficient. But what about broadcast? Does it have any advantage at all? Yes, it has advantage because when a processor tries to read, it already has the updated copy. It doesn't have to wait. So a latency for reads and reads will be smaller. Even the first write will be smaller. The latency for the reads and the first write will be smaller compared to the invalidate protocol, isn't it? Now let's look at an example Snoopy protocol. Let's assume invalidation with a write back cache. So here we'll have to keep track of in what mode a processor has the block, in what mode it has, or in what state it has. The three states that are possible are a shared state where it is just reading. The block can be read, and the value that is available for reading is up to date with the memory and with the data in the other caches. So the data, if it is consistent with the memory and all caches, then it can be in a shared mode, right? It's all processors are doing read, and they can have the same block in shared mode.
Means if one processor is in shared mode, all other caches are also in shared mode.
Yeah, it might be shared or invalid. And a processor can have exclusive access to a block, then it will be the only copy that is there among all the processors. It is writable and it is dirty, right? Now, a processor can also have the same block in invalid mode. In invalid mode, the data present is obsolete. Somebody has already started writing the same data, and therefore it cannot be used, right? So the three states that a block can be present in the caches with processors is shared, exclusive, and invalid. Is that all right? Okay. So as you are saying that a cache controller at every processor would implement the protocol, and the actions that it would have to perform is that when a local processor requests certain thing, then it might put it on the bus. It will decide whether it has to put it in the bus. If it is already having it in exclusive mode and the local processor is reading and writing, it doesn't have to put it on the bus, right? Or if everybody is doing a read on a shared, then it doesn't have to put it on the bus. Otherwise, it will have to put it on the bus. So for certain actions, it will have to generate certain commands on the bus, right? Now, the exact actions, we said certain actions for certain type of accesses. So that will be decided by the controller based on what state the block is being held. If it is a read to a shared, it doesn't have to generate any command on the bus. Whereas if it is a write to a shared block, then it has to generate a command, right? So we'll use FSMs to show what is happening. Actually, to show what is happening or what the controller does when there is a request would be complex, and we'll split that into two parts. One is about the one FSM will show what happens when the requests are coming from the local processor. And the second FSM will show is when the controller monitors or snoops the bus and finds that there is a command being broadcast by some other processor, what it would do, right? So there are two FSMs that we'll discuss. So as we are saying that the block can be invalid, shared, or exclusive. So the first FSM that we'll consider is about only CPU requests to each cache block. We'll not consider the commands being sent on the bus. So let's assume that a read request. Okay, I think we're running out of time today. We'll meet in the next class and we will discuss about what happens for various requests generated in various states. Right, that's the essence of this protocol. We'll look at the directory-based protocol. We'll find out what happens to the cache misses when the coherence protocol works. We'll look at synchronization and so on. That is the next class. So we'll stop here today.